Hello, welcome everyone again to Distinguished Lecture Series number 54, which organized by the Faculty of Engineering, University Technology in Malaysia. My name is Amir Zanariku, and I am from the Institute of High Voltage and High Current, School of Electrical Engineering, Faculty of Engineering, UTM. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Datu Engineer Dr. Mohammad Rafi, the Dean of the Faculty of Engineering, for supporting this lecture. For your information, Distinguished Lecturer Series, we invite prominent professors around the globe to share the knowledge, expertise, and experience, and perhaps to exchange ideas. Hence, we are indeed honored to have with us Professor Frede Blaabjerg from Aalborg University in Denmark. Prof. Frede will deliver in the lecture with incisive power electronic technology qualities today. So for those who know, Frede is a well-known professor in the field of the power electronic system. It is my utmost pleasure as a chair in this Distinguished Lecture Series program in September 2020. Without further delay, I will pass to Professor Mohammad Rafi, our Dean of the Faculty of Engineering, to introduce it, Prof. Frede. Over to you, Prof.
Thank you, Dr. Amir Reza. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome everyone to our 54th UTM Engineering Distinguished Lecture Series. My name is Mohammad Rafiq and I am the Dean of Engineering, University Technology, Malaysia. Today, it is my utmost pleasure to welcome Prof. Frede Blaabjerg from Aalborg University, Denmark. A bit about our distinguished speaker today. Frede Blaabjerg was with ABB-Scandia, Randers, Denmark from 1987 to 1988. He became an assistant professor in 1992, an associate professor in 1996, and a full professor of power electronics and drives in 1998. From 2017, he became a Villum Investigator. He is honoris causa at University Politehnica Timisoara, UPT, Romania, and Tallinn Technical University, TTU, in Estonia. His current research interests include power electronics and its applications, such as in wind turbines, PV systems, reliability, harmonics, and adjustable speed drives. He has published more than 600 journal papers in the fields of power electronics and its applications. He is the co-author of 4 monographs and editor of 10 books in power electronics and its applications. He has received 32 IEEE Prize Paper Awards, the IEEE PELS Distinguished Service Award in 2009, the EPE PEMC Council Award in 2010, the IEEE William E. Newell Power Electronics Award 2014, the Willem Kahn Rasmussen Research Award 2014, the Global Energy Prize in 2019, and the 2020 IEEE Edison Medal. He was the editor-in-chief of the IEEE Transactions and Power Electronics from 2006 to 2012. He has been distinguished lecturer for the IEEE Power Electronics Society from 2005 to 2007 and for the IEEE Industry Application Society from 2010 to 2011, as well as 2017 to 2018. In 2019 to 2020, he serves as the president of IEEE Power Electronics Society. He is the vice president of the Danish Academy of Technical Sciences too. He is nominated in 2014 to 2019 by Thomson Reuters to be between the most 250 cited researchers in engineering in the world. So that is a brief biography of our distinguished speaker today. Here now is Professor Frede Blaabjerg from Aalborg University, Denmark, with a talk entitled Power Electronics Technology, Quo Vadis. Prof. Frede Blaabjerg, over to you.
Hello, everybody, and thank you so much for the introduction. So, also for the invitation to give this this lecture in this distinguished series. So, let me try to share my screen for you and see if we are successful. I think we are. Let me do like this. So I just need a confirmation. Are we okay? Can you see my full slide now?
Yes, Prof, we can see your slide. Thank you.
Super, we go. Okay, so The title of my presentation is naturally about the power electronics technology. Some of you would maybe ask, what do we mean by quo vadis? And this is a Latin word, and the Latin word says that where are we going, or where will it go, or something like that. And it's always hard to say what the future brings, but at least we can highlight what future challenges we have. So this is what I'm going to discuss here today. And first, sorry, just there are some issues here. Yes, so let me start again, because there were some problems with my loudspeaker. I hope you can see it now again. But the point with the quo vadis is, which directions are we going, and where will we go? And I will especially highlight where do we need to do something for the future. Let's see. So here we go. But first, before I go, let me take the first slide. And this is about Aalborg University. Where do I come from? Well, what you can see here is the world map. And of course, you are located in better temperature conditions compared with me. So it's around 11 hours flight up to Copenhagen, which you have here. And from Copenhagen to Aalborg, this is where I am placed. We have Aalborg University, and Aalborg is a small town of more than 200,000 people. And the university was established close to 50 years ago. What is special with Aalborg University is that it is working in a special way in terms of teaching program, and that is that our teaching program is based on problems. So half of the time our students, they work in teams and doing a project, and the other half time they get lectures. So we have a teaching program which we call problem-based learning, and in many places around the world this is also called the Aalborg model. We have 22,000 students at Aalborg University, and we are full university. One out of the 18 departments is energy technology, and the energy technology department works with technology, so not very much about what we call the overall society and so on, but we work with different technology, and we are cross-disciplinary department, because we work both with power generation in terms of electricity, but also related to the thermal heat. So we are looking at multiple energy carriers in our department. But of course, when we take the electricity, we look at transmission, distribution, conversion, and efficient use of electrical power, as well as we are looking at ways, for example, in my country, where for the moment it's become colder and colder, we need to heat up. So in my country, we also need to have a heat distribution. This can be done in different ways, but for example, in my town, we have a power station, and the power station distribute all the waste heat out to the houses. And also other kinds of generation. We are looking at wind turbines, photovoltaic fuel cells, and so on. And of course, you can see in between, we have a lot of power electronics technology. So we are more than 100 PhDs, 40 faculties. And what is also characterizing us is that we have a lot of guests all the time. So we have all the time 60, 80 visiting scholars coming to our university. And you are also welcome to come to the university and work with us. But let me go on with the covariates. And I have fundamentally two main topics on my agenda. One is the basic technology, and the second is one of the important applications as I see it, and that is the renewable energy system and the generation from there. And then finally, I'll have an outlook, and based on that, we can take a discussion afterwards. But let's first look at the components and the technology itself. And as you saw in the previous slide, we have a lot of power electronics in our energy system, and exemplified with many applications where we are consuming power. We need to do electrical power conversion, but we also apply power electronics at generation, wind turbines, fuel cells, at photovoltaics and so on, as well as what is coming more and more, the storage issue. So power electronics is everywhere. And what we are really, really facing now to become a significant boom of the marketplace is that the transportation is becoming electrified. There we need a huge amount of power electronics, both to charge the batteries and also for the whole drivetrain train internally. There will be a huge number of power electronics. And it will not only be low voltage power electronics. We also now see in the cars the voltage increasing to up to 800 volt DC. So this is also what we will call industrial power electronics, which are included there. And the predictions are really amazing, and this is going to dominate the whole market of power electronics. If we look at what is really going on, let me just show you this slide here, and as an example of what we call a transition of energy systems around the world. I take my own country as an example. You can see here the map of Denmark, like I showed before. And to the left, you have a little bit the system, how it looked in 85. And you can see small dots, and there are some red dots. So this was a very centralized power system with a lot of generators. To the right, you have a picture about all the generators we have today. And you can see there are a lot of dots. There are dots on the mainland, but there are also dots out of the ocean, for example, green dots. So that means that we have a lot of renewable generation, and it's really decentralized production. And that technically also means that we are changing the way the generation is going. And so to the lower, you can see that that red dots, they are represented by big synchronous generators, and we have a huge rotating mass. And this is really changing as we are having now as interface between the grid and the generation, we have power electronics. So we are moving towards what we call a 100% power electronic interfaced grid. And just keep a little bit on the spot with Denmark, also the electricity from Denmark. Here are some stats in that respect. So the renewable share of the generation of electricity in Denmark in 2017 was 71%. It has passed 80% in 2020. And out of that, as a 50%, absolute, so that means 70% of the renewables is coming from wind, and this is just going up and up, and that meaning that the renewable share in 2027 will be 90%, and 2035 it will be 100%. And now there are also plans for what we call making e-fuel, and in that way we will see electricity consumption go up, and then we have a sustainable fuel also for car, for trucks, and for airplanes, and so on. So this is an evolution where you saw before how this has been implemented by a lot of distributed power generation systems. If we talk about power electronics technology, well, this has existed for more than 100 years, and I would say it's relatively clear. The important year was 57, maybe 58, depending on who we talk with and so on. But in 57, the thyristor was invented. And the thyristor, based on silicon, could very, very fast be turned on and efficient, operate with relatively little losses, with high reliability. And at that time, it really became possible to do electronic power conversion, low scale, large scale. Before that, we had the mercury rack rectifier, vacuum tube rectifier, and where we had it for special application, it was really nonlinear characteristics. But after that, the things became really the power electronics like that we see today. And then the thyristor diode was developed continuously. In the middle of the 80s, the first power bipolar transistor came on the spot, and a little bit later, the MOSFET was coming. And this was a very big change, because this could really do that we could switch way, way fast with very little driving capability. And then in 85 or something like that, late 85, late 86, 87, the IGBT came, where we had the combination of bipolar conducting characteristic and the switching characteristic of a MOSFET. This was a very big invention for the industrial power electronics. This was moving on, and then in the around 2000, the first wide bandgap devices came on the market, and first of all, the silicon carbide diode. But now, when we look at what is going on in our industry and in a university, the wide bandgap devices are really coming into play, and they are very important for the future directions of what we are doing. Except we can say that there's still a challenge in terms of cost, but already the benefits of the performance of the wide bandgap devices, they are so huge that we can pay a little bit extra for the devices. But in this phase two, as we call it, we have improved switches all the time, losses down, power density up, cost constantly down, reliability was really also becoming better and better. If we look at the circuits, we can say phase one, there were some specific applications where we could apply. This was the circuit we could do. But in phase two, we have had a fantastic time in new circuit topologies. We did new ways of control, analog, digital, constantly, because the devices was improving. The loss could be reduced. We could also do more and more fancy things in terms of digital control. And then I would say, in, let's say, 50 years, this has been going on. And after 2000, if we look at what is really going on, this is not so much about new topologies. There can be a few, but what is really going on now is where at the specific application, we develop technology where packaging, EMI, EMC are important, scalability, digital control, including monitoring and so on, as well as reliability on the spot here. So this is what is going up on now. And this is, of course, a statement from my side that I say that almost all topologies we can see are invented. Now it's more to really make the technology as strong as possible to the application, applying the best components for the given case. If we look at the wide bandgap devices, as of course I could talk about silicon, but if we look at the wide bandgap devices, it's is quite interesting because gallium nitride and silicon carbide, they are really having a big span of voltage range and thereby also application range. So for the low voltage, typically we have the GaN application, and for the higher voltage, we have the silicon carbide. As you can see on this diagram here, where we see the application is everywhere, but there are of course places where it makes more sense to apply the wide band gap devices because the advantage is so huge. And then we can say between 500 volt to 1.2 kilovolt in terms of range, there we have a kind of battle between the two technologies, where maybe for the moment the silicon carbide technology seem to have a good position above 600 volt or something like that, but again technology is also coming up, so we have a kind of battlefield here. And the advantages of wide band gap devices are obvious when we look at the different performance factors. And that is the reason that we are also looking at them a lot. As to the left here on this table, you have the silicon characteristic, you have the gallium arsenide, we have silicon carbide of different ways, and then we have the GaN devices here. And there are some performance factors which are totally unique in terms of the wide band gap devices. If you look at the breakdown voltage, you can see here it's almost a factor of 10 for the same distance. If you look at saturation voltage, you can have double or triple speeds of things. Thermal conductivity is also better, and the operation temperature, which is also very important, can also be higher. Of course, there are other issues related to go up in temperature, but the operation temperature is also doubled or something like that. So there are really many arguments for going on in the wide band gap device area. Fundamentally, many of us power electronic engineers, we are not in the device itself, we are applying them, so we follow what is really going on, and year by year we can see that this is improving a lot. So this is what I will say about the active devices, and then now I'll just have a short discussion about the passives, because what happens now is the wide band gap devices are coming up in switching speed. The limitations will move into the passives. So, there has been technologies for many, many years. We have electrolytic capacitors, we have film capacitors, we have ceramic capacitors. You can see here on this slide here where they have their advantages and disadvantages. And it can be, and it will be, the limiting factor in terms of the future technology. And what is really going on now, because we get those switching devices, are to see if we can, by a combination of passive components and active components, maybe squeeze the size of the passive components, because the size of them, there are not really any physical, there are physical limitations in really squeezing the size of those components. So we have to think new, and what I'll put on the presentation today is that one trend is going towards that, combining capacitance, small capacitance with an active circuit, then you can get exactly the same characteristics as the passive, and you can squeeze the size, and maybe you can also change capacitor technology in order to have the same performance. So here is shown an active capacitor fundamentals, and that is, of course, you want two terminals for an active capacitor, and the idea is that you have some passive elements, you have some active switches, you have some control unit and also power supply, and then you try to get the same characteristic like a big passive capacitor by applying an active capacitor. So what is an active capacitor? An active capacitor, for example, for a DC, as a DC capacitor, is a combination of a small capacitor and then an active circuit where there is also a capacitor, but this is behaving on a low voltage side, and we have a relatively large capacitance here, but low voltage, so the physical size is not big. But this is acting like a capacitor would act for the bigger value of the capacitance. So this circuit topology is shown here. So what you need is small capacitance, and then an H bridge and inductor here, and then a capacitance here. And what you can achieve by this is illustrated here. This is the frequency characteristic. Here you have the frequency characteristic of 110 microfarad passive capacitance. Here you have the characteristic for 1.1 millifarad. And what you can achieve by this circuit is that you have 110 microfarad capacitance in this active capacitance. And then by control, you are able to control it so that seen from the terminal characteristic, it behaves like 1.1 millifarad. And so you have here, of course, for very, very low frequency, it's not possible, but beyond 50 hertz or something like that, it is possible. And this is illustrated here. Here you have the active capacitor. And you have here an active capacitor put into a DC link. And here you see the characteristic of the DC voltage at when we are applying the active capacitor having 110 microfarad. And here you can see the same characteristic in case that you are applying a passive capacitor of 1.1 millifarad. And we have even a smaller ripple by applying the active capacitor. And the size has also been squeezed a lot. And here you can see what it is. It's a film capacitor. It's an active circuit and so on. So this is going on, really. As capacitor manufacturers are really want to look at this, because what we maybe can do is to take out the electrolytic capacitors and then apply film or ceramic capacitor. We can squeeze the size in general, plus we can also achieve a higher reliability. And you can also imagine, because we have here a controlled capacitor, you can on the fly change characteristic of the capacitor, because you are having a digital control system. What is really needed here is GaN devices, where you can switch very, very fast and have a high bandwidth in terms of the frequency. This we can also carry over to an inductor. So here you have the fundamental about the capacitor. We can also do that for the inductor. And this is illustrated here. Then you have a kind of current source here in the inductor, and still have the same behavior. And this is illustrated by a circuit here. Here you have an inductor, a smaller one, and then this one here should behave like a bigger one. You have fundamentally some of the same circuit configuration. And what you can see here of frequency characteristic of 8 millihenry passive capacitor and 28 millihenry passive inductor and 28 millihenry passive inductor. And what you can see here is you are able to apply an active inductor where you are squeezing the size in terms of inductor size from 28 millihenry to 8 millihenry. And that is, of course, also interesting if the cost and can come down, and of course also combined with size reduction. So this was the first topic in terms of what is going on. So the devices, in my opinion, they are really driving the power electronics technology. No doubt, immediately when we see better components, we also can apply that in our circuits. Wide band gap devices are moving fast, but silicon is still there because it's so reliable, it's so cheap, and so on. And of course, in general, making the base material as a gallium nitride, silicon carbide, this is where the critical things is in terms of making the device reliable. Reliability needs to be more proven on wide band gap devices. This is the challenge we have, but a lot of things are going on there. We will see new packaging techniques because of the wide band gap devices, because just a small inductance can demolish the performance of the components. Lower volume, higher power density. We'll see that in a lot of application, and these are critical parameters. We will see new equipment design, because we need to do that, because the switching performance is 10 times faster than we have seen before. We also need new skills, So if there are professors here, we need new skills, for example, from the antenna domain in order to do the physical layout. And the tools we are applying, not only 3D, find the elements, but also how things are radiated in space, thermal things, and so on and so on. So even maybe in six dimensions, we need to think in terms of doing the design. We are still in a technology development, so what happens there is that we are lacking of models, so there are ongoing activities we need to do there. The passive components can be a bottleneck, like I highlighted here, and the active components can be an alternative with more flexibility. And then last but not least, I think we also have to adapt our curriculums to the new power electronics technology. Okay, let me take one of the important applications where I also see a lot of interesting thing going on, and that's of course the renewables. And we can say that from, let's say, 2000 and maybe even before, the renewable was not seen as something. Now it's really seen as something, and it is also seen as the main generation if we look into a carbon emission-free future. And before, so we had a renewable in terms of hydropower, and this is the blue one here, and you can see the installed capacity. And this has been raising for renewables from 800 gigawatts to more than 2,500 gigawatts of installed power in 20 years. And this is just going to continue. And if we look at how is the share between the conventional power and the renewable power, you can say, this do not mean a lot, but it means a lot. And so if we look at today, what is non-renewable of new new capacity we are installing, and what is the renewable, we can see here that 72% of all new electrical power generation capacity is renewable today. Only 28% are non-renewables. So the renewable market is really there. And if I look at countries around the world, what are their ambition 2030, 2050, this is becoming even more towards the renewable side. So this is really amazing. If we take my own country, we also have ambitions, just as a case, we can say, where we are living way north, so the sun is not so strong. We have a lot of wind. And what you can see here is the wind, how much this is going to cover the overall share of the consumption. So this is what you can see here. This will be 70% in 2070. And we are going to install renewables as a wind turbine technology, both at onshore and offshore. Offshore is more expensive, but there we also have more wind available. If we take the two main technologies which have taken part of this growth in renewable generation, this is no doubt wind power, and this is PV. So let me just discuss a little bit what has been going on in the wind power. And you can see here, this is the accumulated installed capacity of wind power. So in 2019, 620 gigawatt was installed, and the market in 2019 was 59 gigawatt. The average size of the turbines was 1.8 megawatt, but now they are becoming bigger and bigger because as they go up in size, we are able to lower the cost of energy. And looking at the technology development of the wind turbine technology, this is really amazing, seen from an engineering perspective. In 1980, this was 50 kilowatt of size. In 1990, 500 kilowatt. In 2000, 2 megawatt. So in 20 years, we have increased the size by a factor of 40. And what we see today is 12 megawatt. And what we are looking into is 14 megawatt of wind turbine. And you can see the blade diameter is more than 220 meters. So this is really amazing construction. But this makes sense in terms of lowering the cost of energy. If we look at what the power electronics have played a role, this is the color you can see here. In the beginning, it was not used. Now it's used a lot, and it's totally needed in order to do the interface to the grid, as well as controlling the wind turbine. And here you can see the roles in the power grid. Before, let's say, in 95, it was a troublemaker. Then in 10 years, it would look that it could organize itself, but it was not playing a major role. But now it's really an active contributor to the grid, and it's also a part of the stabilization of the grid in many cases. Here you can see the manufacturers and the top five wind turbine manufacturers. You have the size here, the power range, you have the rotor diameter, and you have the companies here. And I think what is really important to look at here and interest to look at here is the concept they are applying. And you can see that the companies are applying different technologies, not only one fits all. So we have the double phase induction generator, we have the permanent magnet synchronous generator, we also have the squeal cage induction generator, and we are also applying the synchronous generator as a unit. So seen from a research perspective, we are still having different generators to look at. We are still having different topologies to look at in terms of, for example, scaling up or reducing the cost of the technology. The other area, which is moving very fast, this is the PV cell. It's a PV technology. And this one here is a figure taken from NREL in US, who is every year publishing the record in terms of efficiency for the PV technology. And this is also very interesting because you can see that the efficiency is just going up and up. You can also see there are many different technologies, but for many of them, they go from almost low efficiency to very high, and or relatively high. And the interesting thing here is that those are very cheap to do. So we have not seen the last technology development in terms of PV cells. Here you can see who are the top manufacturers in terms of PV. China has driven the market for a couple of years because they have installed a lot. So there are also manufacturers from China, but there are also other players. And you can see how much they shipped in how much they're able to ship in 2019. In terms of installed capacity, we have passed 580 gigawatt in 2019, and the market here is close to 100 gigawatt. So it's almost a double of the wind turbine. And the main reason for that is that the cost has gone down, but also many can invest in PV. And this is very, very interesting for everybody to do that. While if you want to buy a wind turbine, you need a lot of money. The PV cannot operate without any interface with power electronics. So we also need inverters to connect it to the grid. And there are many players in that. And here you can see who are the major players in terms of companies for this 100 gigawatt market. So there are two Chinese companies, number one and two, and then there are other companies from Europe and US who are also playing a role in terms of this inverter market. So if we just look at where has the growth been in terms of renewables, this is shown here, the growth rate per year. For different winds, bio, hydro, and others. And there is no doubt that if we look back in the last years, PV has really amazingly been growing a lot. I will show some figures at last about where are we in terms of cost of energy. What is driving the technology, both for wind turbines and PV, these are the grid codes. And what we are really trying to do is we try to like the conventional plants are doing, to mimic that as much as possible. So that means the grid codes are dictating that. So if you look at a system here where we have a generator, we have the grid, in between we have the power converters, and the demand to the power conversion here is that high power density because we have in the nacelle high reliability, strong cooling. We have to, on one side, to control the speed, and at the other side, to connect us to the grid. And it is possible to make active power plants by doing this. And the same for the photovoltaics. What we can say for the photovoltaics are that we both have connection at the low voltage grid as well as the medium voltage grid. So the specifications are a little bit different, because if you are connected to the medium voltage, then there is higher demand in terms of taking active part of the grid operation, while at low voltage, the most important thing there is that you are not disturbing and you are not running into a kind of islanding operation in case that the grid is falling out because of safety. But in general, as again, we have the generator here, we have the grid, and in between we have the power electronics in order to do the job. And the demands are high efficiency, high reliability, being able to do maximum power point tracking for the PV side, and being able to interconnect to the grid where we have a high quality of electrical power. Let me show a different power electronic configurations. And what we can say for the PV is that as a power electronic engineer, you work with all kinds of power levels. We connect power electronics just to a module. There we can really optimize the operation of one module and really be adaptive according to the conditions on the panel. Then we put them in series, the panels, and then we have a string connection. And then we put them both in series and parallel and put them into what we call a central inverter and relatively cheap interface to the grid system. So those configurations will typically have from DC to DC and then DC to AC. And the DC in the middle will be 400 volt, 750 volt, and even up to 1.5 kilovolt in order to do the operation. And the discussion is often, should it be with isolation or not? So the trend is 100% clear that we want to have a system where we do not have any isolation, because it costs always on the efficiency. But if we have transformer isolation, we can, in a PV system, have a low frequency transformer or a high frequency transformer. And the high frequency transformer will squeeze the size, but we are losing in terms of efficiency. While a transformerless one, well, there we have a direct conversion. The challenge there is fundamentally the thing that the voltage we have here at the grid will also be seen at the panel. And when we are then switching converters, then the panel voltage will drop up and down. And because we have a very big area, we will have a coupling to ground. So there will always be a capacitance to ground, and we will have some earth current, ground current flowing there. If we have ground current flowing, we have a risk of degradation. We have to deal with this. And there are also some issues in terms of ground current protection. The trend and the amazing things really going on is that in the past, we could not believe that we were operating in a system where we have more than 1 kilovolt in the PV system. But now it becomes more and more standard. We are increasing in voltage, so we have 1.5 kilovolt at the DC level for the larger installation. This saves, it gives us a saving in terms of cost, also in terms of achieving a higher efficiency, because then the current flowing in the wires are not that high. And the risk, the things we have to look at here is on the long term as a potential degradation because of this high voltage, because we know there is a potential of degradation, as well as we also have to look at the design of the converters when we have such kind of high voltage. But they are already on the market, so this is what you can see here. Sungo, ABB has such kind of solutions where we go up in voltage. But there are for sure things to be looked at in that case. If we look at the wind turbines, we have two main configurations. One is a double-fed induction generator system, and second one is the synchronous generators. In the double-fed induction generator system, we are only dealing with the slip power in the generator system, but we have an AC to DC and DC to AC converter to do the job. the power level of this one here is typically 30% of the whole power level, but we are able to control the full power of the wind turbine system. So of course this is attractive from a cost and efficiency perspective. The challenge in the system here is that if something goes wrong at the grid, then we can also see it at the generator side, at the stator, and we have to be able to cope with that, because this is transferred directly into the rotor side. So there is a trade-off of what we have to do in special situations and having a low power converter. The popular system, more and more popular system, is this one here, where we have AC to DC converter to the generator and DC to AC to the grid side, and in between we have a DC link. And this is decoupling the two systems, and this is very, very attractive in terms of operation of the generator side, in terms of operation of the grid side. We are truly having converter topologies below 690 volts. This is two level illustrated here. And this gives a certain way of protecting the overall system. Here we have a back-to-back converter. It could also just be, if it is a synchronous generator to this side here, then it could also just be a direct rectifier, and then we boost up the voltage so we can connect to the grid. But the voltage is also going more and more up. So we see for the very big wind turbines, for example, the 10 megawatt, 8 megawatt, that the voltage level now is moving above 690 volts. So we are having medium voltage. And in that case, the three-level converter is also playing a role. But the main topologies applied today are the two-level voltage source converter. And then they are put in parallel in order to have, let's say, redundancy and being able to be scalable up to, let's say, for example, 6 megawatt. Everything is moving into big parks. So we have power plants, and here is one photo from Denmark. This is a 400 megawatt wind farm in the ocean. And this can be done in different ways. It can be done by AC transmission to the shore, or it can be done by DC. And of course, distance is something which is dictating which technology we are applying. But here you have AC technology, where you go from turbine up to a high voltage AC. And what you can see here is naturally that you are applying transformers. The DC technology can of course be where you have here. It can both be DFID and it can be a full-scale power conversion. Then you have a medium voltage AC grid, and then you transform up, and then you have AC to DC converter at high voltage, and then you have at the other side also the same. The thing is, of course, if you look at the conversions here, that it could be interesting to avoid DC to AC conversion and then have a DC grid and then have a kind of transformer here and transform up to the voltage. This we have not seen yet, but this is really something I see in the future being explored more. How can we do this? Because we can avoid reactive current and so on by having a DC, and we are also avoiding some power stages. What is going on in this field is that storage is put into play, and as well as being able to do active reactive power control in the wind farm. So storage is coming into the wind turbines in order to do power smoothing either at the DC link here, or in a centralized way in terms of doing a little bit more overall power smoothing of the power production, because we have a wind variation. But storage is also becoming more and more interesting, because we want to start up the systems without having a grid. Otherwise, we are dependent on the grid. This is one part. Another way we use more and more power electronics is for the reactive power compensation, either by a STATCOM or by an SVC, in order to compensate, let's say, for the reactive current, because we are applying cables in the system. And this is also applied in many wind farms. Two things I will just highlight before I end my presentation is that there is a big discussion about how are we going to control the wind turbine systems. And today, almost all are controlled in that way. They produce active and reactive power. This is illustrated here. And this is what we call a grid feeding system. We are dependent on how the overall grid is behaving. This is dictating the frequency. This is giving us the voltage all the time. And then we are just feeding power, active and reactive power, into the grid system. And this can be done like illustrated here. But as we have less and less systems which can generate the system as a synchronous generator, then the wind farm maybe have to form the grid system. And this is illustrated here. This is technically, theoretically possible, where the references to the wind turbine operation is frequency and voltage, like the synchronous generator is on the big power station. And this is a very, very big discussion. How much should we do of mixture in the future power system, as well as how are we going to do the what we call, for example, a virtual synchronous generator in a smart way, so it's behaving like we want the grid to behave in the future. So this is something to look at. Another thing is that we also know that wind big synchronous generator, they have emulation as inertia, and this is a part of the frequency regulation. So we should also implement such kind of behavior in the wind turbine system, so we have this kind of smooth operation of the wind turbine system. And here is shown an example of a permanent magnet synchronous generator, where we are able either to use the to emulate like inertia, where we are looking at the DC voltage as a in the power conversion, or we can also use the turbine itself to emulate having inertia. We have a lot of inertia in a wind turbine as such. So renewables, solar power is really fully competitive with fossil fuel today. It has pressed wind in the last years, so cost of energy has also gone down for them. Wide band gap devices, they are interesting for the converter technology. But we should, of course, have in mind when we talk about the inverters that the major cost is not the inverter. This, there are many other costs also, so, but it's a part of it. Grid costs will change, in my opinion. We will also put more smart condition monitoring intelligence into the control. The discussion about grid feeding, grid forming, I just highlight that this is going to be there and how do we do in very big systems. Storage is coming into system solutions. How to do black start in the future grid system. We have always inrush currents when we energize a transmission system. How to do protection. And I think renewables, they are really competitive, very competitive. And let me just end my presentation with two slides. This one here is where I try to show for you what is the evolution of the new renewable power generation cost for the last 10 years. What you can see here is US dollar per kilowatt hour. This is where we were in 10 and 19. And you can also see what is fossil fuel cost range dependent on the market. And here you have the cost for biomass, geothermal energy. You have it for hydro. This is very low in general. But then you have here the evolution of solar, concentrated solar, and then on offshore and onshore wind. And you can see this is really, really being competitive with what we can call the conventional fossil fuel based system. So, a summary, electricity is going, in my opinion, to create the modern world. So we will see much, much more electricity being used, because we are also going to convert electricity to other fuels, for example, e-fuel and so on. The power electronics is the key technology for this society, and this is really now a super scaling technology. Cost of energy is going down. What we also have to work on is that the failure rates are not too high. And we see a paradigm shift in terms of how to do power system operation, exemplified with what I showed you before. If you look at the component side, wide band gap devices are there. It will change our circuit design. But the device is coming. They will continue to improve. So we have to be on the spot there to do the models, both in terms of behavior and reliability. And now the passive components are a challenge, in my opinion. And then for different reasons, reliability engineering will be become important, because if that is failing, then people's belief on the technology will also decrease. But this is also an opportunity in general, because customers, they maybe don't care about reliability. They just want things to be running, so there can also be service to be income for the manufacturers of the technology. When we put a lot of power electronics into the grid system, we can also face stability issues, because we are dealing with a lot of new frequencies when we have a grid-connected power converter. So we have to look at this and to be able to master that in the future in order to have a reliable power system. And then we can say electrification of the transportation. This is really a very, very big application for the next two decades, combined with the renewable generation, in my opinion. And this will shrink the cost of the power electronics even more. And in that context, AI is all the time being discussed. We will see this being used in order to do design, in order to do future control, and also apply AI in condition monitoring applications. And then I think we have to rewrite and update our curriculums because a lot of new things are coming on the scene, and we should ensure that our students, they have the best skills in order to do the work. And then much, much more. So I just want to acknowledge some of my people in the lab who have provided me those slides, and then thank you very much for your attention, and a little bit sorry with the beginning, I had some issues with the speak. I had some noise from there, so sorry. But I hope you enjoyed my vision about the power electronics technology, and I'll be happy to answer some questions.
So thank you so much, Professor Fred, for your amazing informative lecture and very, very interesting talk. So I believe we learned a lot from this lecture today. Let me inform all the viewers from Malaysia and around the world, you are welcome to post any relevant question here. If you have any question, you can post it to Prof. Fred. I will read the question from Facebook comment also. So, Prof., I think it's clear the question for you. Can you see the question?
Yes. Yeah, I can try to write. I would like to ask if the country with low technology in producing renewable, how are the authorities or person in charge who can order? Okay, yes, if you take the Danish case in terms of let's say the deployment of renewable generation, this has been driven by the politicians. So they have set up goals, incentives to do investment of renewable technology, and this is a little bit top-down approach, which I think we will see in many, and it is going on in many countries. However, I see the technology becoming so cheap in general. So I would also see that what we can call the NGOs, or what we call it, will start investing in, for example, PV panels, small microgrids, in order also to have their own electricity production. So, so I think we will see top down by governments, and then we will also see bottom up, because the technology now becomes so cheap that more and more can afford to introduce this technology. Then I have another question. What is the minimum wind speed for generate power for home use? As if we take the small wind turbines, which are especially useful for smaller size and so on, they can be run already at 3 meters per second and give a little bit. But of course, calculate the how much power is available. So calculate how much is available at 3 meters per second. It's not so much, but 4 meters, then it really starts to be something, because the power is cubic of the wind speed.
Thank you so much, Prof. I think we have one more question here.
Yeah, thanks. What is the difference between the active capacitor and passive capacitors in case of tolerance, stability with time and temperature? Yeah, that is a very good question. And that is one of the motivations for people to develop the active capacitor, because when you put this controllability into the capacitor, then tolerance you can adjust, stability you can monitor and control, and if temperature is varying, then you can also adjust according to the parameters you see in the system. So this is exactly this is one of the motivation for the active capacitor, is to shrink and have a much better tolerance performance by applying this. It's a very good question.
Thank you so much for response to question. And I think we have one more question.
Yeah.
From Noor Ahmed Otiamo.
Yes. What are the challenges to produce sustainable and renewable energy in terms of system development and safety? How do you solve the emerging problems? I think the discussion is way broad in general, because we can talk about big power systems, and we can also talk about, let's say, smaller microgrids and so on. But I think if we talk about the big systems, this will be how to, let's say, go from conventional synchronous generator operation to converter-based operation. How do we do this? Plus, of course, also to have solutions when we have no renewable generation in the power grid, right? And so how do we do the storage? Which system do we have to put up in order to store energy for the good times? For the smaller level, I would say the storage is also the same, but for the small systems, I think cost is also an issue to get that enough down so people can invest into it.
Thank you so much, Prof. The other question is from Dr. Hassam Kamyab.
Yes, the question here is, why is renewable energy expensive? And let's take that. I think the slide I saw show you for you before indicate clearly that we are becoming more, the renewable energy technology is really on the same level like conventional power. So I think we cannot continue to say it's expensive. And then about what renewable energy is the best, well, it depends a lot on where you are in the world. In my place, where we have a lot of wind, it's important to put up, and there wind is naturally the best place. If you go to places where there is a lot of sun PV systems will naturally be the best things. So it's very, very site dependent, and it has to be evaluated case by case. And the future about renewable energy, I am way optimistic in terms of the future of the renewable energy. I really see no fundamental limitation that in decades we are able to rely almost dominantly our energy supply by renewables. So I'm very positive and I'm very glad to see, in general, this evolution we see globally in terms of renewable power generation.
Thank you so much, Prof. I think due to limited time, we have to finish this lecture. And if the viewers have more questions, can just email later. I believe Prof. Fred is happy to answer all questions. Thank you.
I'll do my best to do it.
Prof. Thank you so much. Now I give back to Prof. Rafir to close and remark. Over to you, Prof. Rafir.
Thank you, Dr. Amireza, for chairing and moderating the session. And a big thank you to Professor Fred Blaabjerg, our distinguished speaker for today. Lots of interesting stuff that you mentioned there in your slides. And I believe that all the audience are very happy to see all the things that you shared with us. A bit about Denmark, we've never been there. I believe that Amireza has also not been there. So perhaps this is the best time, Amireza, for us to go to Denmark and visit Prof. Red. Yeah?
You're welcome.
Again, Thank you so much, Prof, for accepting our invitation to speak at our UTM Engineering Distinguished Lecture Series. And to all of our audience around the globe, thank you for watching our Distinguished Lecture Series. We have many more lectures for you. Do stay tuned. And until then, bye-bye for now. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.